This may very well be the most chaotic wrap-up I've ever posted in the past 10 plus years, and I'm going to do it anyways. Bibliophiles of the internet, today I'm back to wrap up what I read in March. So here's the sitch. If you saw my last video, you know I was originally planning to share my March wrap-up on the first Friday of this month. That did not happen because the weather on the weekend I was supposed to pre-film that wrap-up was horrendous. Fun fact, and I'm sure you can tell this, I did film my February wrap-up in the middle of a storm, and both the filming and editing process were the actual worst, so I was not going to do that again. So that weekend passes, now I'm looking ahead to the next weekend, and there's supposed to be another storm. I will not be silenced 2 weeks in a row. So for the next 2 or 3 days, right after work, I'm gonna come in here, I'm gonna sit down, I'm gonna record 2 or 3 reviews, I'm gonna edit them all together, and it's going to be a wrap up. That means camera angles are gonna change, clothes are going to change, light quality and color might change. We're just gonna deal with it, I'm gonna deal with it, everyone's going to survive, everything's gonna be fine. Let's just do this. As you may know, March is Women's History Month here in the States. I'm pretty sure every book I read was either about or written by a woman. I don't know if I was fully aiming to do that, but it worked out that way anyways, and it was a pretty good month, I have to say. Jumping right in, the first book I finished in March was The Space Between Worlds by Micaiah Johnson. PRH Audio very kindly provided me access to the audiobook, which is read by Nicole Lewis. This is a queer multiverse sci-fi story set in a world where scientists have cracked the secret of traveling between parallel universes. However, the catch is that you can't travel to a parallel world where a version of yourself still exists. Luckily, our main character, Kara, is in a very unique position because for some reason, her parallel selves are very good at dying, so she's able to travel to a lot of different worlds where she collects data for continued research. But when one of her 8 remaining doppelgangers dies under very mysterious circumstances, her tenuous existence and plans for the future are completely upended into chaos. Content warnings for depictions of murder as well as ruminations on death and grief, instances of blood, graphic injury, and graphic violence, mentions of suicide ideation, and references to past experiences of abuse. The truest thing I can say about this book is that it's badass, and it fucked me up in ways I never expected to be fucked up by a sci-fi story. I went into this hoping it would be a complex, entertaining sci-fi mystery or thriller, and it absolutely fulfills all of those genre expectations, but I didn't realize that the writing and the characterization would be so philosophical and emotional, or that it would awaken parts of myself I didn't even know were sleeping. This story fundamentally understands what any good multiverse story worth its salt understands, which is that the multiverse is both a scientific concept and also a proven universal truth, because each and every one of us, by definition, is a multiverse. Across our lifetimes, there are countless versions of ourselves that live within us, that live and die, that we destroy, that we create, that we rebirth, that we envision, that we become. And all of those realities, all of those truths, are simultaneously being held within us. And because that truth is at the core of this story, all of the intricate world building, all of the external action works and makes sense. Because the idea that in order for us to live, another version of ourself has to die, has both metaphorical applications and literal applications. So as I was going through the story, there's a sense of deep emotional catharsis happening on multiple levels that just kept the synapses in my brain firing the whole way through. Kara is a huge part of pulling off that complexity because there are so many layers to her. She was born in the wastelands and had to destroy that version of herself and her past in order to work for this super powerful research corporation. She constantly has to negotiate and renegotiate away parts of herself, not just so that she can do her job, but so she can also exist. And even the title itself is so satisfying because it addresses so many different conflicts in the story. As a traveler between worlds, Kara does spend so much time in that dark in-between void, but she also feels like she doesn't fully belong in other ways. Again, as someone who came from nothing and now works with very wealthy, powerful people, she finds that she can't blend in with those around her, but she also is no longer claimed by those who are still in the wasteland. friends. She also has this hot and cold relationship with her handler, who she flirts with and she's hopelessly in love with, but who can't seem to decide whether she reciprocates those feelings. And so because there's equal plausibility of them being together or them not ending up together, they end up dangling in this undefined in-between space. So there's a lot happening. There's a lot to think through. There's a lot to feel. And I just found it to be equal parts entertaining, expansive, and thought-provoking. Honestly, this would have been an easy 5 stars if not for the ending of the story, which felt very hasty and rushed and just not as well thought through compared to the rest of the book. But even that is not enough to undermine how incredible the rest of the story is. And what's weird is that the problem with the ending isn't even solved by the fact of there being a second book and a continuation of this world, because the second book is following different characters. So while this first book absolutely has enough content to warrant an entire series, the continuation of this plot is not what we're actually going to be getting in the second book. But don't get me wrong, I am absolutely going to read that second book, and hopefully soon, but this was amazing. Mikaia Johnson is absolutely someone to watch in the sci-fi space. I really love this. I gave it 4.5 stars. After that, I read Just Another Epic Love Poem by Parisa Akbari. Penguin Teen very kindly not only sent me a finished copy, but also sponsored me to make some short-form content about this book's release. I say that to clarify that what they paid me for was to let people know that this book is now on shelves. They did not pay me for my opinions, those are my own, and I am sharing them with you for the grand total of free 99. And I should also say that PRH Audio very kindly granted me access to the audiobook, which is read by Nikki Masood. This is a queer YA romance and coming-of-age story about a bisexual Iranian-American girl named Mitra who keeps a series of moleskin notebooks with her best friend B, and they basically fill the pages of those notebooks with a never-ending poem that they started together when they were 13. These notebooks are basically a safe space for them where they can share their most earnest feelings about their lives, their families, breakups, difficult things they're going through. The one thing neither one of them ever writes about is the fact that they're hopelessly in love with each other, because that could change everything. Content warnings for references to a parent with drug addiction and a history of drug abuse, brief mentions of vomit, references to a character's past instances of infidelity, depictions of anxiety, and some fade to black sexual content. Also worth noting, as I said, Mitra is Iranian and bisexual, and B is queer and Mexican. This was another incredible debut. It hit me square in the heart and really took me by surprise at times, but I think it's a story that so many young readers really need right now, and I'm so grateful that it exists for them. The pitch for this story was that if you like the setting and complex family dynamics of The Lesbiana's Guide to Catholic School and the emotion of Jandy Nelson's immaculately crafted prose, then you would also like this book, and I absolutely agree. I love the structure of the story because the majority is written in prose, but it's also punctuated by these sections of poetry that Mitra and B are passing back and forth to each other, and I found that to be incredibly effective because it kind of creates a double filter through which to understand the characters and their experiences. You get to see what's happening on a narrative level, and then you get to see how the characters process those emotions and those situations through their art. It creates this level of intimacy and familiarity with the characters because poetry is such a vulnerable art form and engages so many more senses and evokes outside-of-the-box connections that you just won't find in prose. The other really big thing is that the story provides an in-depth exploration of the complexity and really the ugliness of healing and forgiveness. This is a huge thing that comes up for Mitra especially because she has a lot of childhood trauma and mistrust that stems from her mother's drug addiction and the strain it put on her family, understandably so. Her parents are divorced, her father has had sole custody of Mitra and her sister for many, many years, and they've had no contact with their mom throughout that entire process. Now their mom has gone through the rehab process. She seems to be doing better, she seems healthier, she has a new job, she just moved, and now she wants to be back in their lives. And that's a lot for Mitra to process. So she's asking herself whether she can trust her mom again, whether she should trust her again, is there a foundation from which they can rebuild this relationship, and all of those things. And I think all of that beautifully ties into the romantic relationship blossoming between B and Mitra, especially because if they take that leap, if they change the dynamic of their friendship, they're also going to be facing a lot of unknowns. A romantic relationship also requires trust. It opens up opportunities for each person to hurt and be hurt. It changes the tenor and the dynamics of what came before. And even though it's not the same kind of love, those are also the things that Mitra is confronting as her mom continues expressing that she wants to be a part of Mitra's life. So I really respect how the story takes us through the ups and downs of that healing process, how the romantic relationship is paralleled with this complex mother-daughter relationship, and how neither of those relationships exist in a vacuum. Things that happen with B bleed over into what's happening with Mitra and her mom, and vice versa. None of it is clean-cut, and I really respect the story for holding space for all of that at once. There's so much nuance in how the story shows how all of us are just as likely to be asked for forgiveness as we are to be the ones seeking forgiveness. As loath as we may be to admit it, we are all imperfect. We all make mistakes. We all hurt people, both consciously or unconsciously, purposefully or accidentally. And we're all so much more than the worst thing we've ever done. Our ability as humans to grow is as painful as it is beautiful. As I read through this story, I was blown away by how insightful, how cathartic, and how healing the writing was. It shook something loose inside of me and really caught me off guard. It wasn't until afterwards that I learned that the author is actually a therapist, and that makes so much sense, not only because the story gives the characters so much grace, but it also proves that this story can offer so many tools and so much language in regards to healing for younger audiences. So it's really exciting to me on multiple levels that this book now exists in the YA space. It's tender, it's emotionally evocative, it's devastating at times, but it's also deeply beautiful and cathartic. I hope we see much more from this author in the future. I gave this 4.5 stars. Even though there's definitely going to be a break between reviews, the next 3 books I'm going to mention were all included in a recent weekly reading vlog that I shared where the goal was to read down my current library holds at the time. I definitely recommend checking that out if you haven't, especially if you want to see my initial thoughts and reactions about these 3 books, so I will link that down below in case you missed it. First of that set was Organ Meats by Kaiming Chung. My library had an audiobook copy which was read by Jen Xiao and Annie Q. This is a weird, surrealist, queer, contemporary story. There are touches of horror and fantasy in different respects, but it is categorically weird with a capital W. It's about these two childhood best friends, Anita and Rainey, who tie matching red strings around their necks and vow to become dogs. They create this whole fantasy world and mythos where they're descended from dog-headed women and women-headed dogs, and striving to become dogs is basically how they're trying to forever solidify their friendship. But when it becomes clear that Rainey's family is getting ready to move, their two-girl dog pack becomes very strained, and they realize that they're far more connected than they ever thought. Content warnings for some graphic imagery, violence, and descriptions of graphic injury, some mild body horror, references to animal death, and some sexual content. It's almost alarming how into this weird-ass story I was, and honestly, I can't even justify that, not that I even have to in the first place, but even just on a craft level, this story absolutely blew me away. I'm gonna be repeating things I mentioned in that vlog, but I just loved the way reading this story felt. It's almost fairy tale-like. There's a childlike wonder to it that's both enticing and disturbing. It's absurdist, it's surreal, it's strange, it's over the top, it's absolutely bizarre. But it also works. The process of reading this story deviates so intensely and so purposefully from what we consider to be traditional storytelling. It's not the kind of story where each sentence is building on the one that came before it to draw the reader to a logical or even concrete conclusion. There are times when there's almost no connection between one sentence and the next, and if you resist that fluidity, you will never find out just how far the tide goes. This is also something I touched on in the vlog, but I very strongly feel like this is not only a rejection of Western Eurocentric colonial conceptions of storytelling, but also a fierce and outright rejection of feminine gender roles and cis-heteropatriarchy itself. These female characters are fucked the fuck up. They're weird, they're disgusting, they're toxic, their friendship is not this beautiful, healthy, easy, feel-good thing, and they're continuously outright rejecting the way women are expected to function within and exist under cis-heteropatriarchal systems. Their connection with trying to be or become dogs speaks volumes as to their understanding of what womanhood entails. The same way domesticated dogs are submissive to humans, they think women are inherently destined to be submissive to the Western cis-heteropatriarchy and to men. So by imitating dogs and willingly taking on the mantle of doghood, they're all at once overcompensating far too much to meet that expectation, and also rejecting the entirety of it outright. As I've said, I think the story is ultimately about connection. It's about how we all want to be connected to something. We all want to belong with, and sometimes even to, the people we care about the most. The story is excavating the kind of desperation and destruction that comes to the surface when we feel like we're losing the people we're connected to. It's about how hopelessly we cling to the people around us when it feels like the rest of the world is outside of our control. It's about the fear so many of us feel about how the world is inevitably going to change the people we love, our relationships, and even us. And how terrifying it is to realize that our love is impermanent. How we might never again have the people we have right now exactly as we have them in this moment. But the truth is that we have no choice but to surrender to that impermanence, to trust the people in our lives and even the world itself to grow and change with us, because there simply is no other way to exist. So this was wild, to say the very least. I went through so many emotions during the reading process, but it rocked me to my core in the best possible way. I am so excited to read more from Kaiming Chung. I think they could absolutely become a new all-time favorite author for me. Let me say this very clearly, I do not care how the masses have received this book. For me, it was very obviously and absolutely 5 stars. So after I read Organ Meats, I did a hybrid read of Behind You is the Sea by Susan Mwadi Daraj. The audiobook is read by Rasha Zamamiri and Ali Nasser. This is a novel woven out of interconnected short stories that are following the residents of a Palestinian-American community in Baltimore. There's a lot of divides between all the characters, including but not limited to things like class, generational disparities, religion, and tumultuous family dynamics. There's no easy way to sum up how all the characters and stories are connected, but the project of the book is to show the complex and delicate ecosystem of this community and how even the tiniest of decisions ripples outwards. Fair warning, purely because there are so many stories here, there are a lot of content warnings to go through, so just strap in and stick with me on this. Content warnings for mentions of parents with cancer, explorations of death and grief, some ableist language, instances of internalized fat phobia, references to diet culture, and instances of disordered eating, allusions to off-page domestic violence, brief instance of gun violence and graphic injury, experienced racism, xenophobia, and ableism, expressions of ableism from a parent to a disabled child, references to misogyny, rape, imprisonment, and murder, and some references to drug abuse. I had such a deep appreciation for the interconnected structure of this novel. I feel like each individual story was so strong on its own and so distinctive, but the nature of those stories inherently change, complicate, and color all the other stories in context. I said this in my vlog, but the actual structure of the book ends up emulating the experience of community, how some of the edges overlap and some don't, how we perceive each other from within community, both positively and negatively. So I think the structure of the book really works. This is another thing I talked about, but I was also pleasantly surprised that we don't get rotating points of view in the story, which is kind of what I expected. Once a character has had their chapter where they get to be the main character, the narrator, we don't read from their perspective again, with one very notable exception. And that scarcity, I guess, makes the reader more inclined to lean in with each new voice. Thematically, I feel like the project of the story is to not only shed light on the complex intersections of community, but something that ties each character together is the fact that they're missing or lacking a nurturing presence in their lives. In one way or another, they've all experienced some kind of loss, sometimes literal, sometimes metaphorical, that disconnects them from their family or even from themselves. So when I thought about it from the point of view of Palestinian diaspora, it made me think about the loss of a motherland, the loss of your ability to be nurtured by your people, your culture, the land and history that shaped you, and how that loss might branch out much further and much deeper into people's lives than we necessarily see on the surface. I do want to again flag that there is one story about a character who's a cop, which is never actually interrogated on page, and another story about a mother with a disabled child that I think, either intentionally or unintentionally, might perpetuate some ableist stereotypes. So keep those things in mind, keep the content warnings in mind as well, but I definitely want to look up this author's other writing, and overall I still enjoyed this. I gave it 4 stars. And lastly, for that specific vlog, I also listened to What Feast at Night by T. Kingfisher, which is read by the incredible Aviroke. This is the second novella in the Sworn Soldier series, the first book being What Moves the Dead, which was a gothic retelling of Edgar Allan Poe's The Fall of the House of Usher. In this story, we're following the same character, Alex Easton, as Alex returns to Khan Family Hunting Lodge. By the way, Alex is trans, gender nonconforming, not seeming to identify in any binary sense. Alex's pronouns are Ka and Khan, which I will obviously be using throughout this review because we should always address trans characters with the pronouns they actually use. Anyways, Alex is returning to Khan home country of Galicia to the family hunting lodge, and the first strange thing is that Alex and Khan companions return to an empty lodge, which shouldn't happen because Alex's family has hired on caretakers to oversee the lodge in their absence. So then all of them are trying to find out what happened to the previous caretakers and also hire some replacements. But the local villagers are terrified and reluctant, to say the very least, when it comes to taking the job because there are whisperings of a breath-stealing creature haunting the lodge that walks into people's dreams at night. Content warnings for war-related PTSD, some descriptions of injury and death, as well as some episodes of tinnitus. It almost goes without saying, but T. Kingfisher is wonderful. I've loved everything I've read from her so far, and this novella is absolutely no exception. Before I go any further, I do have to say that Aviroke delivered another incredible performance. They've really grown in their voice acting since recording What Moves the Dead, and it really shows. They're able to really create dynamicism and even bring brightness to their narration when the story calls for it, and overall, it was just a really, really great audiobook. What really excites me about this series so far is that it's anchored by these very distinctive characters, which gives Kingfisher the freedom to explore and present different kinds of horror in each new installment. What Moves the Dead is much more gothic. Obviously, it's a Poe retelling, so that tracks. But because this sequel is not a retelling, there's more of an opportunity for the story to not only follow its own trajectory, but also explore Alex's character more in depth. There's a really interesting use of dream magic, dream walking in this story, which gives us a direct line to who Alex is as a person. Alex's dreams are directly connected to Khan past and the traumatic things Khan experienced during the war. Alex often relives those things through Khan dreams. So grappling with this haunting, with this folkloric creature that invades people's dreams, really opens up that space. It makes for a very satisfying story because Alex isn't just contending with this dark creature, but also really contending with and confronting Khan past. I also touched on this in my vlog, but I think the pacing of this story makes so much sense to me because it feels almost sleepy in and of itself, which obviously directly connects back to the sort of monster of the week. So it's more of a slow burn horror story that really creeps up on you, very gradually builds and builds until it flips itself on its head, which I think is both appropriate and extremely effective. So I really like this a lot. It delivers on Kingfisher's trademark ability to craft stories that are both horrific and somehow lighthearted at the same time. I really hope that we get so many more novellas in this series, and I think I would give this one 4.5 stars. After that, I picked up my Patreon pick for the month, which was actually a short story. It was A Dead Djinn in Cairo by P. Jelly Clark. I also listened to the audiobook for this, which is read by Suhaila El Attar. This is the first story set in the Dead Djinn universe. If you don't know, there are these 3 short works that lead up to P. Jelly Clark's first full-length adult fantasy novel, A Master of Djinn, which is one of my big reading goals of 2024. I know you don't have to read the short works in order to enjoy or understand A Master of Djinn, but but I'm coming to see that I really enjoy P. Jelly Clark's writing, so I want to, and this is my first official step in that universe. So this short story is a historical steampunk fantasy mystery. I love all those words together so much. It's set in 1912 in an alternate Cairo where mortals, supernatural creatures, and even divinity, question mark, coexist in the same space. This melding of worlds has created the need for some kind of overseeing authority, which led to the creation of the Ministry of Alchemy, Enchantments, and Supernatural Entities, which is where our main character, Fatma El-Shaawari, works as a special investigator solving supernatural crimes. Content warnings for depictions of death and references to suicide, some instances of violence, and some experiences of receiving misogynistic comments. This is super short, like 43 pages or so, so I don't have too much to say. The big headline here is that P. Jelly Clark continues to absolutely impress. His fantasy worlds really excite me and intrigue me, so I can't wait to keep going on this trek through the Dead Djinn universe. I thought this was a really tightly paced and well thought through steampunk fantasy mystery. Fatima is an incredible inspector character to carry us through this fantasy world. She is queer, she's badass, I want to know so much more about her. So I'm really glad that she's going to be steering the ship in the full-length novel, so to speak. But overall, this story has everything you want in a good mystery, just packed into a very concise space. There's an interesting hook, there's intrigue, there's a hero you can root for, there's action, and there's even some delectable twists along the way, which is kind of wild when you're only working with 43 pages. I don't have the brain space to really back this up, but the experience of listening to this story almost gave me similar vibes to Even Though I Knew the End, even though they're almost nothing alike. But I do think they share similar components in terms of having these classic, almost noir crime scenes at the center, investigation, contending with angels and divinity and all that stuff. So even though they're not a one-to-one match for each other, I do think there are some similar vibes. Like I said, I'm intrigued, I want to know more, I want to read more, and so I will continue to journey into this universe. I'm really glad I finally got a chance to start this prequel series of sorts, and I think I would give this short story 4 stars. Then I finally got a chance to listen to Strike the Zither by Joan He. I got the audiobook from my library and it was read by Nancy Wu. This is historical ancient Chinese fantasy. It's set in an alternate fantasy version of the Xin Dynasty in the year 414, and the land is basically in chaos. There's a puppet empress installed on the throne, and the realm is fractured into 3 main factions led by 3 warlordesses who are all hoping to claim the continent for themselves. Our main character, Zephyr, has actually aligned herself with a lesser-known 4th group who don't currently have any land to their name but are still trying to win this war regardless, and Zephyr's role is that she is an incredibly powerful and talented strategist. When Zephyr is forced to infiltrate an enemy camp to keep her own soldiers from being slaughtered, she meets the enigmatic Crow, who is an incredibly astute strategist in his own right. And she also realizes that their enemies might be even more powerful than she thought. Content warnings for death and animal death, war-related imagery and trauma, including descriptions of torture and execution, graphic violence and injury, and some descriptions of consumption and breathing attacks. Something you should know about me is that I love Joan He. I've loved her ever since she came onto the scene in 2019 with Descendant of the Crane. With that Chinese historical mystery, I knew she was going to do so many incredible things in the YA space, and I feel like she's almost gone to a new level with this duology, which is kind of saying a lot. I will say up front and very clearly that this is not a 5-star book. It does have some very notable craft issues I will touch on later, but in terms of dynamicism, intensity, and straight up entertainment value, this is an incredibly strong opener for the series. I will also say that this duology is inspired by Three Kingdoms, which is a classic piece of Chinese literature, and I have to be real and say that I don't have any knowledge of that, and I don't have a strong grasp of the historical context in terms of this political division, which even though this is an alternate fantasy version of that time period, it is at least inspired by historical events. So that's context I simply do not have. I don't think you need that context to enjoy or understand the duology, but I did want to just level with you in terms of what I personally know, which is pretty much next to nothing, and to also point out that if you do have that familiarity and that context, you might get even more out of this series that I'm just simply not equipped to address. All of that said, This was wild. The story is told at a breakneck pace, starting from the very first page and never once stepping off the gas. You get dropped right into this battle sequence. You see Zephyr making these life or death political maneuvers right off the bat, so you almost don't understand what's at stake to begin with, but you also know that there are undeniably high stakes in play. To me, this honestly almost feels like the YA counterpart to She Who Became the Sun, and I don't say that just because they're both Chinese historical fantasies and therefore inherently the same, but because thematically there's a lot of crossover between the two. Both have characters with this insatiable ambition and hunger for power, and even though I would say that She Who Became the Sun is much more epic in scope because it has a lot more space, the warfare of that story feels very similar to this one in the sense that you know it's never actually about what's happening, it's about the next 10 moves afterwards. So I was actually kind of surprised by where this story is able to go, especially because it dramatically shifts gears about halfway through in a way that I'm not going to spoil, but that shift takes the story from being a straightforward political and military drama to being something much more exciting and expansive. Because it's so intense, because it's so fast-paced, the story is able to cover a lot of ground and make a really strong impression with each new development. Even though it does have its flaws, which I'm about to get into, I was still fully invested and extremely curious to see where the story was going to go next. All of that said, I think the biggest thing working against this story is that because it's so fast-paced, it can feel like there's connective tissue missing when it comes to relationship dynamics and key narrative events. It's difficult because on one level, I really respect the craft of the story because the narration is told from Zephyr's point of view, so the narration itself is very tight and terse, which works on the one hand because it's true to who she is as a strategist, first and foremost. And the writing is also reflecting that characterization because as a strategist, Zephyr plays a lot of things very close to the chest. She's constantly hedging her bets, thinking ahead, predicting her chances of success, and as a strategist, she knows that her chance of success is much higher if no one suspects her next move. So again, intellectually, I respect how the author is able to execute that because it not only creates tension in the story, but it also emulates characterization. But the downfall of that choice is that sometimes the story will take a turn or a relationship changes, and we as the readers don't really know how we got from point A to point B. So there's benefits and there's drawbacks to that style of narration, and there were definitely times where I felt like the story wasn't quite strong enough to overcome those drawbacks. And as you would expect in a story like this, there are these vital relationships that are either very intense or incredibly emotional and intimate that at times left me cold because there was no connective tissue between friends becoming enemies, enemies becoming lovers, lovers becoming enemies, etc., etc. Things happen so quickly that you don't get a chance to feel the full emotional impact. It puts me in this really weird place where my feelings towards the story overall are positive, and I definitely wanted to finish the duology ASAP, but then my feelings are also mixed in regards to certain aspects of the story. I really don't like giving these super specific nitpicky ratings, but this first book really and truly does feel like it's 3.75 stars. It's definitely not strong enough to be considered 4 stars, but it's also not as unsuccessful as 3.5 seems to suggest, at least in my mind. Now, I did immediately afterwards jump into my arc of Sound the Gong, which is the second and final book in this duology and sent to me by Roaring Brook Press. It comes out on April 30th, so in just a few weeks. I'm actually not going to give this one its own review right now because I just don't have anything substantially different to say about this second book as compared to the first book. Pretty much all the same craft issues and also the same successes carry over into this sequel as well, and because it's a direct continuation of book one, there's really nothing I can say that wouldn't spoil the duology in some way. Again, in terms of pure entertainment and intensity, this was top tier in those regards. This is one of those fantasy series that I think would make such a killer TV show, but sadly, I just don't think we're ever gonna get that. Again, I had relatively the same issues with this second book, and for me, it balances out to about 3 stars. So at long last, those are all the books I read in March. Was this wrap-up a disaster? Was it a masterpiece? I have no way of knowing because I haven't seen the footage yet, but should I break up my wrap-up filming across multiple days in the future? Let me know what you think. If you've read any of these books yourself, please come share your thoughts in the comments down below, or feel free to let me know your favorite thing that you read or watched or did in March. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, educate yourself, be kind to yourself, take care of yourself and others, and I will catch you on the flip side of the page.